All right, so we're continuing where we left off, talking about numbers. And the last thing I mentioned in our last lecture was a little brief definition of accuracy and precision. So we're going to pick up from there. So accuracy versus precision. So accuracy is how close you are when you take a measurement to the actual or accepted value. So for example, there's an accepted value for the density of gold. There's an accepted value for the boiling point of water. And these values, even though they're still technically measurements, they've been measured with the best equipment. And so these are kind of the accepted standard. So if you're in a lab and you take some measurements, you would be able to then compare how close you were to the actual published value that you should have gotten, you know, based on the quality of the equipment that you have. Precision, on the other hand, is a little bit different. Precision is how close multiple measurements are to one another. So if I measure something three different times, or three of us measure it, do we all get the same answer? So it doesn't necessarily have to do with whether we're correct or not, but are we all getting the same thing? I think this dartboard is a very good analogy of it. So this would be good accuracy and good precision. It's good accuracy because if you were aiming specifically for the bullseye, you hit the bullseye, so you were accurate. But it's also good precision because, again, all three of your darts hit in the same location. Now, this one shows us poor accuracy. Assuming we were aiming for the bullseye, we missed. But we do have good precision. Every time we throw, we are hitting in the same basic. Now, somebody did ask me in class, could we have the opposite of this? Could we have good accuracy and poor precision? And that's kind of tricky, actually, to have, because if we have good accuracy, then that would mean that we're hitting the target. And then, so then how could your precision really be bad? So what I said was, I don't think we would do that to you on a test anyway, but I think what you could have is you could have two people and they were both accurate, but one was more precise than another. In other words, we could both throw three darts and both of us hit close to the bullseye, but maybe one person's darts are more close to each other than the other. So maybe I throw and I also hit the bullseye, but mine are like here, here, and here. And that person's are all like a little closer. Then we would both technically have fairly good accuracy, but one of us would be less precise. But again, I don't know that we would do that to you on a test. And then here's poor, this would be me playing darts, poor accuracy and poor precision. I totally miss the bullseye, and I can't even aim and hit the same place every time. So when you do this in a lab, again, the accepted value is the correct value based on references, you know, reference books where they've done these measurements, and it's the accepted standard. Your error is going to be this, the difference between your experimental value, what you got, and the accepted value, what's the acceptable value. So it's the experimental minus the accepted. But most of the time, and on your test, we don't ask you for your error. We actually do a calculation called percent error. So our percent error tells us how far off we were. And the way we calculate it is this way. It is going to be the absolute value of the error. In other words, it's going to be the absolute value of your value. Experimental, remember, is what you got. Minus the accepted value, which this is, remember, this would be the one that's published. And then divide that by the accepted times 100. So here's a sample one. So let's say you're going to try this and you read that the accepted value for boiling point of water is 100.0 degrees Celsius. You go to the lab and you measure it to be 99.1 degrees Celsius. What is your percent error? So this is our published value. This is our experimental value. And so this is what our work would look like. So it's going to be the absolute value of what you got minus the published, over 100, in this case because it's 100 degrees Celsius, and then times 100%, always times 100%. Now, because this is the absolute value, you should never get any negative numbers. Also, as far as if you're wondering, how do you do this in a calculator, this is my suggestion for your calculator. I know some people have fancy calculators that can, you can put a lot of things in at one time. You can do 99.1 minus 100, hit the equal sign. Then after you hit the equal sign, you don't have to enter that number again, just leave it. Take that number, divide it by the 100, and that's what they did here. And you can then go ahead and multiply by 100%. You don't need to do that in a separate step. Now, if you don't know, if your calculator doesn't let you put in absolute value, you're probably going to get negative for this because you're subtracting this way. So you can hit the plus minus button to make it positive, or to be honest, you can just memorize that this is always going to be a positive answer. So just ignore the negative sign. You don't normally ever do that, but in this case, you could just ignore the negative sign. So these are two other problems. So in class, we paused and I let everybody answer these and then we went over them together. So if you want to pause the video to work this out. Okay, so I've put up my work for both of the problems. So if we look at our first problem, I plugged it in. Again, if you plug this into your calculator, I always make it a point to hit enter in between steps just to make sure, because some calculators do funny things. So I don't put all of this in at once. I put in the 2.45 minus 2.71 and hit equals, and then take that answer. You can go ahead and make it positive if you want to. Since it's always going to be absolute value because it's a positive number, then I hit divide by 2.71 times 100, and the answer you should get is 9.59%. Now, you may wonder, where do I round to? And we haven't talked about that. That's actually coming up in one of our next lectures. But I would say a good rule of thumb for now is just round to the same number of digits as your original numbers. So you see how my two original numbers had three digits? I rounded my answer to three digits. Okay, now I put up also the work for person A and person B at the bottom. So this is what it would look like, the setup. And then I need to actually erase some of this because it's gonna get in the way of the answer. So I'm gonna erase this. Here are the correct answers for person A and person B. And the question was, who was closer to the correct answer? Who had better accuracy? And the answer would have been person B, because they were only off by 21.8%, which is still not fantastic, but definitely closer to the correct value. And again, this doesn't mean if you get a high percent error in the lab that you did a bad job. Honestly, remember, you're limited by how good your equipment is. So it could be an equipment issue that your thermometers were faulty or your balances weren't measuring accurately. So keep that in mind too. Okay, units. So we've talked already briefly about this, but remember, you can never report an answer that's a measurement without giving the units that you're using. Otherwise, it doesn't make any sense. There are two main systems that are kind of widely used, and you know probably that in our country, we tend to rely more on the English system. You hear about gallons of milk. You're measuring miles per hour, how fast we're going, rather than kilometers. And rather than liters and grams of things, we oftentimes are, your canned goods are in fluid ounces. So why is it that we use the metric system in science? Well, it turns out that the metric system, it's preferred. It is the units that we call the standard units. It comes from, they're called the SI units, Système International. And it was sort of agreed upon by the scientific community that these would be the units everyone would use. And that would make it universal. So I want to just walk through them very quickly. We're not going to do conversions right now or anything like that, but I do want you to be familiar with some of the units we're going to see. So for mass, the standard is the kilogram. Our balances, when we measure things in class, are going to measure in grams. You can convert to kilograms. Kilograms are usually for weighing heavier things. You can easily convert back and forth. And we'll talk about that momentarily. For length, if the standard is the meter, again, a meter stick is pretty big. So a lot of times what you're measuring with in class that's easier is centimeters, which again is still meters, really. We're just changing the metric prefix because we're using a smaller amount. For time, it's seconds. For temperature, it's Kelvin. We'll talk more later about why it's Kelvin and not Celsius. A lot of people think it's Celsius, but it does have to do with the fact that Kelvin doesn't have negative numbers, that the lowest you can get in Kelvin is absolute zero. And then for amount of a substance, it's a unit called the mole. And we'll be talking about moles later in the year, so we're not really going to worry about them right now. But it is a way of measuring how much you have, in particular when we're talking about atoms and molecules, things that are very tiny. Okay, so just to show you why the metric system is so much easier to use. So this is a little snippet of a ruler, and we can compare inches to centimeters. So 1 inch, here's 1 inch right here, and if you notice, it's about 2.5-ish centimeters. If you look it up, an inch is about 2.54 centimeters. You don't have to memorize that. If I wanted it in millimeters, millimeters are the little teeny tiny lines. So instead of counting, 1, 2, and then 0.54, it would actually just be, you could literally count them up, and it would be 25.4 millimeters. Now notice, if I wanted to convert from centimeters to millimeters, all I had to do was move the decimal place. And that's the beauty of the metric system, is that it's always in tens. So if I want to go to centimeters or millimeters or kilometers or just meters by itself, all I'm ever going to have to do is take my decimal and shift it to the left or the right. On the other hand, inches are measured in eighths. So it's going to be much harder to cut this into pieces. And whenever I want to convert from like inches to feet or to miles or whatever, I have to memorize a conversion factor. That there's 12 inches in a foot, that there's 3 feet in a yard. You never have to do that with the metric system. To go from centimeters to millimeters, I just move my decimal place. So that's the beauty of the metric system. That's why it's really the standard, is because it's so much easier to work with, to convert between units. And so it's universally the accepted system. Now, every step, like I said, is either just going to go 10 times larger or 10 times smaller when we change those metric prefixes. We are not going to use all of the metric prefixes in here. Like, you're never going to see deca. We really don't use deca or hecto, or probably not even deci. The three that you see the most common are going to be kilo, centi, and milli. There's actually one chapter where we're going to use one that's even smaller. We're going to talk about nano and nanometers. We're going to measure light. And a lot of times light is measured in nanometers because visible light is, its wavelength just happens to fall into a range where nanometers make more sense than using centimeters or meters. But anyway, so that's it. That's everything for our first section. In our next section, we're going to jump into measuring. How do we measure and estimate? How far do you estimate when you do a measurement?